And now it seems that we have lost Christian for some reason. But I see, okay, Christian, you were gone for a moment.
Yeah, hang on. We need to switch screens. You are showing us a presenter here right now.
Okay.
Okay.
Just the first icon here.
Yes. Yes. Okay.
Perfect. Thank you. Perfect.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the introduction, and I'm very glad to be here on this conference, and I thank the organizers for inviting me to talk about hydroborides as solid electrolytes for all solid state magnesium batteries. And so the first question occurs: why are we interested in all solid state batteries? Here we see the typical layout of a liquid electrolyte magnesium battery, where we have a metallic magnesium as the anode, we have a cathode mixture, and all immersed in an organic liquid electrolyte separated by a separator. And we heard several presentations today talking about the electrolyte, discussing the challenges that are accompanied with this liquid electrolyte. There are compatibility issues, there is corrosion, the electrolytes may be reactive, toxic, there are safety aspects that go together with a flammable liquid organic electrolyte. And of course, there are lots of progress, and especially the group around Max developed some non-corrosive, chlorine-free liquid electrolyte, but the question remains, can we replace the liquid electrolyte and get rid of the liquid electrolyte altogether and go for a purely solid state battery? In an all solid state battery, we of course keep the metal anode, but we replace the liquid electrolyte by a solid electrolyte that that works as electrolyte and separate at the same time, so separating anode and the cathode. And the solid state electrolyte has certain advantages. The promises of the all solid state battery is that we can increase the energy density and the power density of the battery, that we can increase, for example, the thermal stability, but that we may also reach a higher operational safety. So especially in the field of lithium batteries, solid state batteries are on the roadmaps of the big car manufacturers. When you look at their concepts for the future, the solid state battery is also one future possibility as a next generation lithium battery. In this case, the solid electrolyte is the key component. And of course, we require high ionic conductivity of the electrolyte, low electronic conductivity, so we don't want to have a short circuit and increase the shelf life. We need a large electrochemical stability window so that we are compatible with the magnesium metal on the one side and with high voltage cathodes on the cathode side. Of course, we need a low gravimetric density to really increase the energy density. We would like to have favorable mechanical properties so that it's easily processable. Ideally, it should be solution processable with a low toxicity, economically viable, and so on. And of course, the question is there a candidate that fulfills all these criteria? Unfortunately not, but the hydroborates are a class of material that fulfill most of these criteria. So the hydroborates are salts that contain boron and hydrogen. The typical example here is the BH4 minus ion, the tetrahydroborate ion, and then the larger cage like B10H10 to minus, B12H12 to minus, or these nidoborate, these open structures, the B11H14 minus, but also chemical relatives of these ions, such as the carbohydroborates, where we replace one boron with a carbon, with the result that the charge goes from two negative to one negative. This has the advantage of reduced charge density and reduced Coulombic interaction. And there is also the halogenated form of the hydroborates that show an increased electrochemical stability. This all started as lithium borohydride, LiBH4, was discovered as solid electrolyte at high temperatures. So at around 110 degrees centigrade, lithium borohydride undergoes a structural phase transition, and the high temperature phase is accompanied by a much higher conductivity. So here we reach 10 to the minus 3 Siemens per centimeter, so around 1 millisiemens per centimeter. This is a liquid-like conductivity. And lithium moves nicely in this lithium BH4 environment, as the lithium and the BH4, they have similar ionic sizes. To improve the conductivity, different strategies were tested, like nano-confinement, anion mixing, and one of the best results were achieved mixing lithium borohydride with lithium amide. In a certain stoichiometry, we reach liquid-like conductivity of 1 millisiemens already at 40 degrees centigrade. This material has been used as a solid-state electrolyte in a symmetric LTO half-cell test with two LTO electrodes on both sides. And this was cycled at different C rates. And here we compare the solid-state electrolyte with a typical liquid electrolyte. And we can see that up to a rate of 1C, we get comparable performance of the solid electrolyte as compared to the liquid electrolyte. Unfortunately, this electrolyte shows a limited oxidative stability and is unstable versus lithium metal. So this might not be the ideal candidate for a solid-state lithium battery. However, going to the mixed B10, B12 anions, we could establish a stable 3-volt battery. So here you see the ionic conductivity of sodium 2B12H12 and sodium 2B10H10 in blue and black, and they both show also a phase transition to a highly conducting phase. However, the room temperature conductivity is very low. Mixing these two in a 1-to-1 ratio, we get a solid that shows no phase transition and that shows 1 millisiemens at room temperature for the sodium case. And we could build a battery with a loading of 7 milligram per centimeter on the cathode side, and we could compare the solid electrolyte with a standard liquid electrolyte. And we can see that the performance is quite comparable. These cage-like closure borates have a higher stability. They have a lower charge density compared to the BH4 or the NH2, and they are perfect for larger cations like the sodium. So here the short summary. So we have conductivity of a liquid-like conductivity at room temperature. We have a high thermal stability. It's compatible with metal oxidative stability. We can process it from the solution. So this classical slurry-based techniques work, and we could build an all-solid-state battery that could cycle for 250 times. Even better results we could achieve replacing the sodium 2B10H10 with the carba compound sodium B11H12. So here we have the cathode material is the solid electrolyte mixed with conductive carbon and the active material, the pure solid electrolyte and the sodium anode. And we could cycle this here for more than 800 times, and the cell is still cycling in our lab. And we can see here from the charge-discharge curve that we indeed reach here 3.8 volt as an average average voltage. The oxidative stability here is like 4.2 volt versus sodium sodium plus, and as I said, this is a very is very stably cycling. So the question is, can we transfer this to magnesium? In general, the research on magnesium conductors and magnesium batteries is much less developed than for lithium and sodium batteries. But it would be nice if we could also use hydroborates for magnesium conductivity for an all-solid-state magnesium battery. And therefore, we would like to know what magnesium hydroborates are available. Are they compatible with magnesium metal? Do they support stripping plating? Can we reach high conductivities? And do they possess the sufficient electrochemical stability to be used in a battery? What gives us a bit hope that it works is that lithium borohydride works in a liquid electrolyte. So magnesium borohydride in DME or THF was tested in proof of concept batteries versus the standard Chevrel phase as the cathode side, and then pure magnesium borohydride or a mixture of magnesium borohydride and lithium borohydride was tested. It works. Of course, we observe also strong fading, but proof of concept battery was there. If we look for different solid electrolytes for magnesium, then we see that pure magnesium borohydride is a very poor magnesium ion conductor. So we see here around room temperature, we see very low conductivities, 10 to the minus 11, 10 to the minus 10 range. There exist some magnesium solid state conductors, but they only work at higher temperatures, and they're typically this Nazicon type. It's magnesium zirconium phosphates. They work at high temperatures. However, as we heard also in the talk before, the magnesium 2 plus ion has a similar size to the lithium ion. So the idea is to use the same tricks as in the lithium case. And indeed, Ronan Leroyer investigated in detail the magnesium borohydride magnesium amide, amide system. The motivation was that lithium and magnesium have similar ionic radii, and that this may very well work. The highest conductivities were found in this ratio, and we observe an activation energy of 0.84 electron volt and conductivities above room temperature here in the range 10 to the minus 6, 10 to the minus 5. And we could observe stripping plating and a stability window of like 1.5 volt. The problem with magnesium is, or one of the challenges of magnesium is the high charge density. So one idea would be to reduce the charge density of magnesium by using chelating ligands to reduce the charge density and to increase the size of the cation. For example, we can use ethylene diamine as a chelating agent that coordinates to the magnesium. So when we mix magnesium borohydride with ethylene diamine, we have the magnesium coordinated with the BH4 and with the ethylene diamine. In this way, we produce a quite large cation that helps for the transport. But on the other hand, of course, the cation gets rather big, which is more negative for the transport. However, we reach here a conductivity of 10 to the minus 5 Siemens per centimeter at 60 degree. Activation energy is very similar to what we see in the magnesium borohydride amide system. The stability is a bit lower, and we could show reversible stripping plating of the magnesium when we work with a magnesium anode and the Chevrel phase cathode. And the question was, when it works with ethylene diamine, does it also work with other chelating ligands like diglyme, monoglyme, or TMEDA? And we tried this in different ratios and in different mixtures. And you can see here the Arrhenius plot of these materials. And the highest conductivity we got from the magnesium borohydride with the ethylene diamine, the system that we used as that we tried out first. So chelating ligands might be promising, but we need to find other ligands that combine higher conductivity and higher stability. So when we now look on the chart of the solid state conductors, we see compared to the original figure that I showed more in the beginning of the presentation, we have the pure magnesium borohydride, we have the magnesium borohydride amide, we have the ethylene diamine with the magnesium borohydride, we have the latest finding of the magnesium borohydride with ammonia incorporated, which is also similar to the ethylene diamine case. But still, we suffer from the limited oxidative stability. In the case of sodium, the trick was to go to higher borates, to these cage-like anions that are more stable. Does this work also for the magnesium case? And the answer is we do not know yet. So far, we synthesized magnesium B3H8, which is a step between the borohydride and the higher borates. So in the synthesis of this cage-like ions, B3H8 is an intermediate, and it's good that we could synthesize this. We also measured the conductivity of this material, which is a bit lower than the pure magnesium, than the magnesium borohydride amide material, but the hope is that we can synthesize higher borates with this. So this is just accepted paper. The equivalent to the closure borate, the magnesium B12H12, there have been many attempts to synthesize this material in a pure solvent-free way, but so far, all these attempts fail. Magnesium B12H12 suffers from the strong coordination of any solvent to the magnesium. So upon when we synthesize it, we always have it in the solvated form. And when we dry it, we decompose the material. There is also DFT calculations that indicate that this material might only be stable under pressure and might not be stable at all in the pure form. So this is still an open field, and there are many compounds to be synthesized and to be tested for the conductivity. And with this, I would like to come to my summary and the outlook. I hope I could show you that hydroborates are very promising as solid state electrolytes. They are compatible with metal anodes. They have high ionic conductivities in the case of sodium and lithium. They have a low gravimetric density. So when we replace a liquid electrolyte with a solid one, when we keep the volume, we do not change much of the weight. They're very soft mechanically, easily to being processed in cold pressing. They have a high thermal and chemical stability and a low toxicity. On the magnesium case, we still lag behind with the ionic conductivity. The electrochemical stabilities as reported so far are below 2 volt, but on the positive side, magnesium stripping plating has been shown. The main challenge I think here is as also in the case of magnesium cathodes, is the high charge density of the magnesium that makes it even more challenging to transport in a solid electrolyte. And to go to a magnesium all-solid state battery, I think we need solid electrolytes with higher conductivity and higher electrochemical stability. The synthesis of higher borates may be one way to go. Anion mixing, using chelating ligands, or also nanoconfinement that I did not mention in this presentation, are all ways to increase the conductivity and stability. Also adding halides may be important. And of course, we would need new cathode active materials like in for all magnesium batteries. And with that, I would like to thank all the people who did most of the work, that are mainly people from my lab at EMPA, but also collaborators from the University of Geneva, the group of Hans Hagemann, and of course, I have to thank the Swiss National Science Foundation for financial support, and you all for your kind attention. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation, Arndt. I think we have already two questions in the Q&A section, Max.
Actually, I see one. There's a second. So the first question is from Bhaskar Akisetti about the sodium version of the solid state battery. Does the sodium borohydride, is the sodium borohydride stable in open air? And how could you address the sodium metal electrolyte contact resistance during the sodium ion stripping and plating?
Yeah. In the sodium case, the sodium electrolyte that we used was this mixture of the sodium B10, B12, or the CABA. These materials are stable in dry air. They are slightly hygroscopic, so when you handle them in outside the glove box, they take up water, but they can be dried afterwards. And the second question was how we address the interfacial resistance. We can see an SCI formation and the interfacial resistance by impedance spectroscopy. When we start with the fresh cell, we observe no interface, but when we cycle, then we see the formation of an interface as an additional semicircle in the impedance spectroscopy. And we can reduce, and of course there is a contact resistance. However, sodium metal is quite soft and our electrolyte is quite soft, so this gives a nice contact by cold pressing. The active materials on the cathode side, they show very little volumetric expansion upon sodiation and desodiation. So the two materials you see here, the sodium chromium oxide and the fluorophosphate, they show very little expansion so that we maintain the contact. But we also realized that pressure helps. So when we apply external pressure, the system can take higher current densities.
Okay. The second question is there any contribution of protons in the conductivity of borohydride complexes, or the conductivity solely coming from the cation?
Before working on these materials, I used these materials as hydrogen storage materials, and especially the cage-like materials, we have a strong covalent bond between the boron and the hydrogen so that we can exclude a strong contribution from the protons. I would say this is exclusively the sodium that is transported in these materials.
Yeah, I also have a comment rather than a question.
Yeah,
it's about this pure magnesium borohydride versions of electrolytes. I think we should not forget in that case that the pure magnesium borohydride is actually metastable.
Yeah,
it's just stable at around room temperature, As soon as you lift the temperature a little bit, it gets unstable. It's kinetically stabilized. That's all. That means there's actually not a real long-term perspective for such a material in a battery.
Yeah, I agree. And also magnesium borohydride, of course, comes in different structural modifications that may also have different conductivities. The magnesium borohydride was like the starting point as an analogy to the lithium borohydride, where the group of Orimo discovered the high conductivity in the first place.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, I don't see any more questions. There's one. Nice talk, Arndt. In the case of hydroborates, the H- can be quite mobile as well. So how do you distinguish magnesium mobility from H- mobility?
We do not try to distinguish. I mean, we did not observe H-, but I think that there is no H-. I mean, if you're aware of this H- mobility in the closure borates or the carboborates, I'm very happy if you could send me the link to the paper. I'm not aware of that, but I think we can very stably cycle like this in the sodium case for 800 times, and it's still cycling with a good retention, and we see the stripping plating. I do not think that we have much of H- transport there.
I agree. I mean, if you would have a H- mobility and transport, you would block your anode by the formation of sodium hydride.
Yep. Right?
And it seems that this doesn't happen. You know? So I don't think that this is really an issue, but this is an educated guess.
Yeah.
Okay, then thank you very much, Arndt, for this nice contribution. And then we hand over to the next talk.